about 10 years ago, there was a big wave of these very powerful personal testimonies of late diagnosed autistic women who had a really hard life, and you just think these people deserve to be heard and to find out why life has been like this for them. That was the kind of eureka moment for me. I thought there is something different going on in this population which nobody's captured.
Should we start with the current understanding of autism? What is autism, and why do we think about it predominantly as a male thing?
The term actually refers to self-absorption, and it came way back when it was first identified in children. And what characterised these children by the people who first started describing them was their apparent sort of aloofness and aloneness, and the idea that they, or the presentation that they didn't have the need for contact with anybody else. But that's kind of changed over the 80 years or so in which we've been trying to understand what this condition actually is. In the latest diagnostic and statistical manual criteria, there's a focus on two characteristics of autistic individuals. One is to do with problems with any kind of social interaction, and the other is to do with problems with repetitive movements, some what's called stimming, self-stimulation, so hand flapping, spinning, or you know, hair twiddling or something like that. And also very, very narrow focused obsessive interests. Resistance to change is also something which is very characteristic, as any parents or carers of autistic children can tell you. And finally, which has only recently been added, unusual sensory experiences. So highly sensitive to bright lights, loud noises, but also sometimes hyposensitive. So they sometimes don't respond to the sound of their name, for example, which is interesting because it looks as though sensory sensitivities or sensory differences much more common in females, autistic females. So it hasn't been part of the diagnostic picture from the beginning, which could be part of the problem.
So our picture of autism is still evolving very much at the moment.
It is. It has changed. But I think in the public consciousness, there is quite a sort of fixed stereotype of autism, which is what, you know, parents of autistic children say their heart sinks, you know, the Rain Man effect, you know, the idea that there's somebody with very, very strange superpowers and also very bewildering patterns of behaviour. And also in the stereotype is that characteristically they're male.
Yes. And that's something that has been pervasive in the scientific community as well, isn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. And the clinical community. It's one of those stories of a self-fulfilling prophecy. When the descriptions of what was called autism first arrived, there was no comment that it was characteristically male, but gradually as the cases accumulated and then people started collecting prevalent statistics, there it did look as if it was more common in boys, because the cases that were being reported, there were more boys than girls. And the very first sort of epidemiological study, which was done in the UK, found that they were looking at a ratio of about 4 to 1. So they did comment that there were four times as many boys as girls. And that kind of became fixed as a characteristic of the condition. There were sort of passing comments about there being fewer girls. And even in the 1980s, when the description was broadened considerably and included aspects such as Asperger's syndrome, there was observations that there were fewer girls, but there was a kind of, interestingly, Lorna Wing, who's perhaps one of the mothers of autism, said, oh, maybe girls are just better at hiding their signs of autism, which was almost a sort of passing comment. And nobody really went into, so why should they be hiding their signs? You know, why is that more girls doing that? So that was parked for a long time. And then, so in fact, you know, clinicians would say, you know, if a parent turned up with a daughter and said, I'm a bit worried about this behaviour, she can't be autistic, she's a girl, you know, and this is not an uncommon still comment. And so it became part of the clinical literature. And then, as you said, it also became part of the scientific world, which is where I was, because obviously, if you're interested in a particular clinical condition, you take the participants from the already diagnosed individuals, or even if you have a slightly more generous approach and say, well, I'm going to test a whole community, see who's got higher levels of autistic traits, some males, some females, you'll then find that probably your funding body will say, we have to prove that these people are definitely autistic. So they then are presented with the so-called gold standard tests, the ADOS, which is the Autistic Diagnostic Observation Schedule, where people look at various kinds of behaviour they think are characteristic of autism or try and elicit those, and also a diagnostic interview, which is something like 93 questions where the carers or parents of children, if you're looking at children, or the adults themselves, are questioned about unusual aspects of behaviour. Those are called the gold standard tests, and they're very rigid, very, very driven by algorithms. So you have to get so many points and then the algorithm takes you over a clinical threshold or doesn't. And it's turned out that actually those tests themselves, because they are based on individuals who are already diagnosed, are looking at individuals who are male. So even if a girl, you know, somebody says, yes, so maybe she's autistic, she gets to a clinician who gives her the tests, she fails to reach the threshold. So at each point, there's this bias, which is kind of built into the system, which means at the end of it, there are fewer diagnosed autistic females.
So they're almost not autistic enough.
That's right.
To pass the test.
Yes, yes. Mm. Only a bit autistic.
And then what happened when we started to look at the brain? Did we, at that point, start to look at girls and find a difference?
Right. Well, I guess that's where I came in. I thought, you know, fair enough, I'll go through the literature and I'll see what's been found. And that's when I found that actually we hadn't found anything because nobody was looking. The first 30 years or so of research, one of the surveys I did showed that 70% of the studies only tested males or one or two females. And we're drawing up quite interesting models of, you know, what was characteristic of the autistic brain. Maybe this could tell us something about the brain bases of autism. But it was all based on boys and men, which is pretty shocking. Yeah. Because there were autistic. There have always been women who've been diagnosed with autism. But actually, of course, because they were being tested against a male standard, it was only the girls who presented like males who got diagnosed. Right. The ones who had a different presentation, as you say, didn't make the cut, weren't autistic enough.
So when we did that on males, as you say, what did we find out about the brain?
Well, it was interesting because the discovery of different networks in the brain which underpinned social behaviour tied in with an idea that our brains have actually evolved, yes, to give us language and creativity, etc., but also to make us social, make sure we're social, but also had to have a drive to be social. So it wasn't just a sort of pattern of behaviour, it was something we needed to do. And part of the so-called social brain is a reward system, which, you know, this was a good thing, you know, make sure you do that again, and perhaps not a good idea to go through that again, do a U-turn if necessary kind of thing. And one of the areas I'd worked in was like negative social experiences. So some of us, social cognitive neuroscience is a real killjoy because you put people in a scanner and make themselves feel bad about themselves or imagine a situation where they created, you know, it was a real faux pas, or to take part in a video game where they're consistently rejected by the other players, etc. So then you could see the different patterns of behaviour within the social brain. And what was starting to emerge in the early work with autism was that there was an underactivity, less responsivity to negative social experiences in the autistic participants than in the neurotypical participants. And so we started to evolve this model about the hypoactive social brain, an underactive reward system, getting less, you know, enjoyment from social experiences, less motivated to be social.
And presumably less of that that negative feedback, so you don't mind so much if
that's
you
right,
are
yes.
if you are rejected if, or
yes,
if you don't fit in.
You know, it's a sort of shrug, like. And that was the model that was emerging. And it was only when I started to look at all of the studies that had been done on the social brain, which is where it turned out that, as I said, 70% had only been done on males, and of the rest, there were a very small number of females, almost too few to do any comparisons anyway. But then there was also a kind of call to arms within the neuroscience community and saying we really ought to be looking at sex and gender differences. But when they started carrying out those kind of researches, even replicating earlier work done on the social brain with female participants, they found a very different pattern of activity. Female participants were much more likely to respond much more powerfully to negative social experiences, but also to show evidence of constant sort of self-referencing, self-monitoring throughout social, the kind of social tasks we'd put in the scanner. And you can interpret that as saying, well, they mind very much. There has been this long-standing belief that females are more driven to network with other individuals, to be social. And so there is a suggestion, and there was a suggestion early on, that the reason girls were being missed because they were socialised from a very early age to behave themselves, to be nice, to be quiet, not to make a fuss. And so they were almost being trained to be camouflagers, because if they weren't camouflagers, then they were going to behave a lot more like the boys who are very external. The core problem is similar in that there is some difficulty with the means of social behaviour for all of the members of the autistic population. But for the group that spend a lot of time camouflaging and hiding their autism, which if you think about it is a bit paradoxical, if you think being autistic is not worrying about not being social, but the reason they camouflage is because they're so worried, that there is a different story there. So they have the motivation and not the means, which is doubly hard, I think.
In your book, you describe somebody who you call Alice. It's not her real name. And I thought it was very touching how she only sort of really realised about her own autism when she saw her neurotypical son start nursery and saw how he just fit in.
Automatically fit in. I think that's, and I use, the reason she's called Alice, because I have this kind of, which I thought was wonderfully original, metaphor either side of the looking glass. I mean, appreciating that there is a, you know, an original version of that. Because autistic people say they find it hugely difficult, this is, and mainly females talking about this, hugely difficult to understand how people interact with each other. And that's what drives them to do this exhausting lifelong strategies of watching very carefully the popular girls at school or people at work and working out how people relate to each other, training themselves to make eye contact for exactly the right amount of time. And then they actually write scripts, they practice them in front of mirrors. The whole of their day, particularly little girls at school, will be playing out a script that they've got in their head and watching what the popular girls do. And it's exhausting. And that's when they have these kind of meltdowns when they get home at the end of school and throughout life. And even when parents were worried about their daughters, the teachers would say, she's just quiet. You know, she's actually very good. She never makes any fuss in class. You know, she stands quietly in the corner and doesn't get into trouble in the playground. And there's a study done recently where it was shown that if teachers were given a hypothetical story about a child with behavioural problems and asked, do you think this child is autistic, or would you refer this child to be assessed, or do you think they need help? If the teachers were told the hypothetical child name was Jack, they were much more likely to say this child is autistic and needs help than if the child description exactly the same was called Chloe. So even at that point, there's a barrier to say, you know, this is part of this, you know, clamping pipeline, as it were.
So girls often develop these techniques to camouflage or mask their autism. Does that change as they get older?
I think what's really interesting is it definitely changes about the time of adolescence, because as well as all the physical changes associated with puberty, very often in the Western world, it also is associated with moving into a much more complicated social environment when you move from primary school to secondary school. And that's very often the point at which girls who had apparently been perfect and no trouble at all suddenly start expressing or demonstrating huge distress. And I think that's because the camouflages, the scaffolding they've erected is no longer fit for purpose.
Because they've gone into a completely different environment.
That's right. So going away from a nice, safe, although not that safe, but one that they can control arena to a really complicated, highly socially dynamic,
with a whole new set of rules, very complicated rules,
environment of going to secondary school. And that's really the point at which epidemiologically we can see a lot of these problems emerging. So I think people do need to realize that, you know, as we said, it's effortless for us, but it's not effortless for everybody.
Well, I mean, I think everybody finds secondary school quite hard because primary school is very predictable and routine, and the rules are very clear, and it's very supervised.
Numbers, same children in the same class the time. But I think the issue with the chapter about adolescent, I call the perfect storm. If you're female, adolescent and autistic, that is the perfect storm. And I think being aware of that is really important. And people should be sensitive to that.
It sounds like, you know, getting that label essentially earlier on is very beneficial.
Mm. Yes, I think so. I mean, the use of the term label is interesting because there's a saying in arguing about overdiagnosis, you know, labels are for jars, not for people, kind of thing. But I think it's a lot of it's to do with identity. And the late diagnosed women are saying, I felt relief because I found my tribe. You know, I found people who were like me, and I could, you know, if you like, go online and there's amazing resources out there with people, late diagnosed women, exchanging their experiences and all of the difficulties that these women have had, because they are tremendous difficulties, and very often they present in other ways, such as the self-harm and the eating disorders that I mentioned. And so at last, to have an identity becomes very important. But it's very important that the autism is identified early, because you can then assist the children to develop strategies to spot the problems, to allow the outside world to make accommodations so they don't suffer, and to explain to the individuals themselves what this means, you know, that yes, you will be experiencing the world differently. You know, and that's because you've got a different brain, and we've all got different brains, and your brain is different in this way from other people's brains. So to actually give it a positive spin as well, because these women have been hiding this as a sort of shameful secret for some of them 40 or 50 years, until somebody's then said, you know, I wonder if you might be autistic. And almost invariably, well, certainly the people I spoke to and the books, the personal testimonies, huge sense of relief. At last, my life makes sense. And they could realise what it was that had driven their behaviour.
What kind of changes would you like to see? I mean, because essentially this is a good news story. We've discovered that we've missed something and now we can see it. So what needs to happen?
You hope so. I mean, there have been clinicians who've complained that, you know, their waiting lists are long enough as it is. Why we encourage women to get a diagnosis, but that's another story perhaps. I think the change can be just the awareness of autism presenting differently, that the picture, and people complain that the picture is too inclusive, but I think realizing that whatever you think of the autistic spectrum, it's missing the mark in a large part of the population.
Well, look, thank you very much. It's an absolutely fascinating book, and
thank you.
I would urge everybody to read it.
Good.